said we'd be 5 minutes after the time, so to come on time. First of all, very big thank you to Les Glassman and his wife Lucille for making a special trip tonight to be here with us and to give us this lecture. I've known Les quite a long time. He's been a member of the Hebrew Order of David. He's a past president of one of the lodges in Israel and has been actually a tower of strength in the Hebrew Order of David. He gives us a lot of publicity. He's been on the radio. I'm sure you all know about him. His hobby is dentistry. His main function is stamps and traveling around the world promoting Israeli stamps. And I'm sure most of you know about him, but you're going to hear a very interesting thing. I hope you're going to settle in because he's got about 400 slides here and some stuff which you're going to have to translate. I don't know if you'll be able to read all of that. And then we'll get going. So Les, once again, thanks for being here. Thanks for addressing us. And it's over to you.
Should I use the mic? Is it easier if I use the mic?
Yes.
Okay. Stan, thank you so much. I really appreciate it. And a big thanks to the South African Jewish Genealogical Society for inviting me this evening. I hope you enjoyed the talk. I want to thank each and every one of you for coming this evening as well. The HOD, where we are, has a special place in our hearts. As they mentioned, when they re-established Lishkat Yad David in Jerusalem, so definitely I became one of the founding members there, and it's been wonderful. And seeing Stan come to Israel for many years, it was always such a great honor and a privilege to have you there, and to be associated with such a wonderful organization. Also, the HOD building is very special to our family. My late father, Boris, I don't know if you knew, my late dad was a very, very accomplished and well-known stamp collector. He was a judge. And I remember coming with him to see Dave Wax. Dave Wax was Mr. HOD, and we used to buy Israeli stamps from Dave. It was here in this compound, in this complex, before they, I remember it very well as a little kid. Always coming to Dave, I think we used to come on a Sunday morning, we'd sit and we'd discuss stamps, and it was just such a treat to be there. And my dad instilled in, I've got two brothers and a sister, he instilled in all of us the love for stamps, which I think I kept the most, but I'm really appreciative. I just want to start the evening. You see over here there's a letter in Hebrew. I grew up very close. I had the great honor to have a very close connection with my late grandmother. Zahava, maybe you knew her, Altshuler. She was a principal of Bernard Petley. She taught many of the principals, the Wolf brothers. Anyway, my grand came from a place called Mariupol in Lithuania. And we grew up there. Mariupol was part of our DNA. It was, we always discussed it. It was something we always used to ask her questions about where she was born. We were, as kids and grandkids, we were always fascinated about Mariupol. And there were always landsmen, people from her town that used to come in and visit her. And we were just fascinated about it. So, going through all the things many years later, I came across a bunch of old letters. And the inside of the letters, fortunately the envelope wasn't there, but these were some of the letters. And we have one over here. And David, you can just go to the next one. So in these letters, it was actually written, we had a very interesting, it was a very interesting family that my grand, they spoke Hebrew at home, they were very Zionistic. And her father sent the mother and the children to Jaffa in the time of the Turks. They were very Zionistic, they spoke Hebrew, they were religious, and they saw the return to Zion as something real, very real. So the father stayed behind in Lithuania, and he sent his wife and the kids to Jaffa. And the intention was to go to the Hebrew, there was the Hebrew gymnasium, today it's the Shalom Tower. But my grand was there at the age of six in the time of the Turks. And here are the original letters, this is the original letter, that he wrote to his wife and to my grand. And in the letter, if we can go over there, it's actually got the name, Zahavi, he wrote each child, and we have more of these letters. It's such a, we're so honored, and it's just such a mazal that they weren't destroyed and that we have it. And these are the original letters. Here's a letter that we found, and this is the only one that we have. It was written from Jaffa back to Miriam Paul from the eldest son. His name was Abraham. And it says, we can go, I think, a bit further. It says, Eretz Israel, and at the end it was Abraham. And what I did years later, and if you remember Rose Coblenz, she lived in Yeovil, so my late great-grandfather taught her back in Miriam Paul. She came from the same shtetl. And I would go to Rose on a Sunday evening, and we would translate these letters. Somebody in the family found all the letters. These are the only ones that we have that have remained. And they actually rewrote the letters into this book. And by some chance, we were going through all the old books, and I saw this amazing book. It looked like a ledger, but inside was in Hebrew. And these were handwritten from the original letters. But we have, these are the only ones that have remained, the original letters, which were in the book. And we translated the letters, and it's in English. And it was just, you know, it was like touching history. There I was hearing about my great-grandfather writing to the kids in Jaffa. It was amazing. So if we go a bit further, I'm going to show you, I think right till the very end.
That's nice.
We'll go back into those, a bit, one more. Then to get up and now. Okay, if we can put this on play. So last year I was in Lithuania with my wife on a charity tour.
And that means post?
Post.
In Lithuania?
Post office, yes.
Post office. This was the original post office?
I think so, such, because I see the carpet corner.
So my late great-grandfather sent post to Jaffa, was probably from this post office, and he sent money and...
Yes.
Most probably was here from this post office.
Yes.
Because it's very close to where the gymnasium was, yes. And the synagogue, and
the new synagogue, the old synagogue, completely nothing and all.
And this is the used today as the Lithuanian post.
Okay, so most people when they go on these heritage tours, they want to see where the house where they live. That's the most important for us. Because they were so Zionistic, they rented a house. The house wasn't that important for them. But what was important for me, being I've been collecting stamps since the age of 6, was to go to the post office. But for me, having had read the letters and known that the letters actually came from this place, this post office, it was very significant. It was quite amazing. Okay, if we can go back, I'm going to show you something else. Just a bit of, if I can give a little bit of advice, anyone who's got old letters, just keep them and treasure them, because you have no idea one day how important it might be. And on this heritage tour that we were on, there was a, you're just going to go, the Klugman letter, Klugman letter, the Klugman letter, yeah. So, oh, no. Okay, so I'm just going to show, it's going to come up on the screen. On our tour we had, I don't know if you know the Klugman sisters?
Yes.
So they had a postcard, if you can go back again.
That's
theirs. This is the postcard. So they had a postcard there. Their family, their father came from Kovna, which is Kaunas. And they had this postcard. The stamp, you can see, has been removed, which is a pity, because that actually gives more information where the letter was sent from. But it says Kaunas, and then it says something underneath, which no one could really read. And Sue had asked, and Mignon, they had asked so many people in South Africa, do you know, we're going to Lithuania, do you know the address? Because we'd love to see where our father lived. And nobody could decipher it. Nobody knew what was going on. So there we were in Kovna, and we were walking on the main street. It's called Levkas Avenue, which means Freedom Avenue. And we look up. can go to the next arrow. And the most amazing thing happened. Okay, we can play. And this happened all in real time.
Gee. Okay, this is I'll stand close to that way. 3, 2, 1.
This. And when we write normally the address, we put the street and then we put the city. But here it was done the opposite way around. If we can go to the next one.
What was the name of the street?
Lefkas, which means Freedom Avenue. And that's the same street where Sugihara and his wife wrote out the visas, which saved the Mary Shivan 6,000 visas they wrote out. So here's the interview that we did that night. This was at about 12:30 at night with Sue and Miguel. Sue says that there they were walking and they just looked up and they saw there was number 57, and our tour guide Gerlich, he said, this is the street, this is the postcard you had to look at. He said, look, here's where the apartment is. So when I took that video, it happened in real time, it wasn't staged, I was there at the right time, and they just looked up and then they saw their father's home where he once lived. It was remarkable. So if they wouldn't have kept this little postcard, you know, for them, I think that was the highlight of their tour. And for us, just to be there to witness it, it was really incredible. Okay, now, I was going through a few photographs just 2 days ago, and I came across this. Okay, you can see the stamps being torn out, which is a pity, because today, postal history has become actually more important than collecting the stamps. It's collecting the letters, because you actually see the history, and you see where it came from, where it went to. Anyways, I saw this letter, but what was amazing about this letter, it's dated 1933, and it was sent to Kaunas. And I had found a letter previously when I was going through part of the old books. It was also from, if we can go, I think back, this is from, this was from, okay. Yeah, I think this way. Okay, this was a letter that was sent in 1936 to South Africa to, again, maybe more. No, okay, so going back. Anyway, it doesn't matter. It was sent to Johannesburg in 1936 from Kaunas, and it was sent from Celia Luria, who was my great grandmother. So I didn't know, and most of us didn't know, that she had gone back to Lithuania, and she was there from 33 to 36. So we have the original contents of the letter. It's all in Hebrew, which now I intend to have translated, and it's actually discovering our history. We didn't know that she had gone back, and thank God she left in time before the outbreak of the war in the Shoah. Okay, so I was very, Stan wrote in the, it was in the Jewish press about tonight's talk, and he said, with stamps, he said, philately will get you everywhere. Yeah. And the truth is, it really does. I've been collecting stamps since the age of 6, and I first started with the whole world, and then I limited it to dogs and cats, and then I collected Jerusalem. When I went on a pun with King David, I got a few postcards, and I knew I was very familiar with the stamps which were on those postcards. So I started collecting postcards with the stamps, and then I started collecting the personal history of Jerusalem. And I've got a one-frame collection of pre-philatelic personal history of Jerusalem. And it's not that expensive to have pre-philatelic with actual different post offices. I knew I couldn't afford it, and being in Israel, just making a living is not so easy, but the pre-philatelic I was very interested in. And I managed to get two envelopes of Montefiore, the original Montefiore envelopes with his signature. And I've exhibited them in a few countries. And it's actually, there's going to be a virtual stamp exhibition in Bloemfontein, and it's going to be this month, from the 21st and the 22nd of July in Bloemfontein, a virtual one-frame exhibit, and my frame of Jerusalem is going to be there. So I sent scans of the collection, and they're now having it with iPads, and it's going to be on screens, so you don't physically have to even bring the collection. It's going to be a virtual, it's the first time I think they're having it here in Bloemfontein in this month. So when I once exhibited Mozambique, and I collect Mozambique. My late father had a wonderful collection of Mozambique, and I continued that collection. So I exhibited in, this way. Afterwards, it's going to go much easier with the slides. This is it. So I exhibited in Tel Aviv my Mozambique collection, and I got a frantic call from the Israeli Philatelic Federation saying that somebody urgently needs to speak to me, and they gave me the number, and I contacted this person. And she said she has to buy one of my covers. So I said, which cover is it? And she told me there's a cover about Kibrit from Byra to Alexandra. And I thought, it's a nice cover, but it's not the most valuable cover in the collection. It's an interesting cover. So I said, why do you have to have the cover? So she said, we always knew that there was a Kibrit family, which is our family, in Alexandra. We had no idea that they were in Byra as well. So I said that they have to have this cover. So I said, I'll do something. I'll make a color photocopy of the front part of the envelope and the back part. Unfortunately, there was no contents to the letter, but for them, being in Tel Aviv, just looking at this exhibition, they saw my cover there. I had no idea that this was a Jewish family that had written this letter, but for them, it was very significant. So that was in Tel Aviv, and that shows, just keeping, just looking at the letters and seeing the names. In the second part of our lecture, you're going to see something actually quite interesting about the personal history and how significant it can be. Okay, I'm going to go, Stan, okay, if you just go a bit forward. Okay, I'm just going a bit back, sorry. Here we go. Okay, I've been very fortunate when I came to Israel. It was always a dream of mine to kind of represent Israel. And being involved in stamps, I exhibited in a few countries, and then they asked me if I could be the commissioner. So we're going to show a little video that they came to my house and they took it. I didn't prepare anything, but this is a very short video that Haaretz, the paper Haaretz, did of me, and I'll explain a bit as we go along.
I'm Dr. Les Glassman, I live in Jerusalem. I've been collecting stamps from a very young age. I was very fortunate to be the Israeli commissioner in Jakarta, Indonesia, for a World Stamp Championship exhibition. The theme was bridging the world of peace through stamps, and by officially inviting Israel to participate, I think it was very significant because basically the two countries, Indonesia, which has it's the most populous Muslim country in the world with over 250 million Muslims, has no diplomatic relations with Israel. When we arrived, we were extremely warmly received. Most Indonesians had never met an Israeli before, let alone anyone wearing a yarmulke, and the response was extremely positive. When I mentioned I was from Israel, people were very, very interested to know more about the country. My collection is Mozambique and Mozambique Company. It's not the rarity of the stamps, it's just the display that I've done a lot of research on it. Mozambique Company was an area inside Mozambique that was semi-independent. It was a company that lasted for nearly 50 years that had a bit of independence. And one of the features of the independence is they issued their own stamps separate to Mozambique. Just giving a little school kid a envelope coming from Israel with a stamp of Israel, with a message from Israel, they received it so warmly. They were so happy to to have it in their possession, that I gave it as a gift. I'll remember that forever. It was really wonderful. It broke down all barriers. The message of peace through stamps, it really does work. Just as a stamp knows no boundaries. So I think when you connect with people, when you have similar ideals, and when you just look at each other as individuals, it's just wonderful to see that you really are part of a family of nations.
Okay, so I didn't prepare that. They just came to my house and they heard that I was going, that I'd been in Indonesia, and they wanted to interview me. And then they just put the camera there and they said, "Speak." So I did that little interview. But this was the invitation. This was the invitation to it was in Jakarta, and Indonesia has the largest Muslim population on earth. And we really didn't, Lucia and I, we were invited, we were the Israeli commissioner. We really didn't know what to expect. They had sent me the bulletins, the various bulletins, and this is the original bulletin from that exhibition in 2012. And in the bulletin, I just enlarged a little bit, they have all the different commissioners. So here they put my name with Israel, and you can see a bit further down, okay, I don't know if you can see, we'll pass it around, was the Iranian commissioner. And at that time, 2012, as it is today, the relationship between the two countries could be much better, put it mildly. But if you can just pass it down, I think you can see a little bit better. It was very interesting. Later on, when we actually had the exhibition, which I found quite amazing, is that they put the different commissioners and they put the Israeli flag. And this, you know, when they had the opening of the exhibition, the mayor of Jakarta opened it, the governor of the province, there was television coverage, it was in the press, it was a really big deal. It was also the 10th anniversary of what happened in Bali, the terrorist attack. So when they took us on outings, we were like royalty. We went in these buses with escorts, and we really felt like royalty. But what was amazing with this is in the main catalogue at that exhibition, they had the Israeli flag. And under each exhibit, I brought three exhibits with me, they also had the Israeli flag. And many Muslims, well, it was mainly Muslims that came to the exhibition, and we really just didn't know what to expect, but we were really, really very warmly received. The only frightening thing is when we got to the airport, I used my South African passport. They don't accept an Israeli passport, but they knew that I was coming from Israel. But Lucy and I got a bit of a fright, because as you come into Jakarta Airport, they have a sign there warning death penalty for drug traffickers under Indonesian law. So we weren't carrying any drugs, but you know, to be welcomed with a sign, it was a little bit frightening. I wore a cap, and then we were in the taxi. They were taking us to the exhibition and to our hotel, a very nice hotel, where they have the non-aligned movement was held in that hotel, and they have the conference center. And then I thought, you know, I'm not going to wear the cap. I'm just going to take my cap off, and I'll wear my yarmulke. And I kept my yarmulke on all the time. And these are just pictures that you can see that I was together with, you know, you like I said in that little video clip, it really breaks down barriers. Here I'm with somebody from Saudi Arabia, and there I'm with my yarmulke, and we posed for the pictures together. This is quite an iconic picture. What happened is that I had extra first aid covers that the Israeli Philatelic Federation had given me, and I just gave them to these kids. And you know what? It says from Israel very clearly. When they received it, it was like they had received gold. They were so happy. You can see on their faces, smiling, and they couldn't get enough. And I gave quite a few of the kids. Those are religious girls, and these are more secular kids in Jakarta. They were at the exhibition. And the smile on their faces, it's something that I think my wife and I will always remember. It was very, very special. And for us, giving an Israeli first aid cover that they had in their collection, I think, was really significant. Yeah, this is at the exhibition, and you can see how they put up the exhibition on frames together with the two local Indonesians that helped at the exhibition. And I don't know if we were like a bit of I wouldn't call it a celebrity, but because we made the trip and we made the effort, there were quite a few European countries that declined to attend that exhibition. And because Israel made the effort, and it was quite, you know, getting there is not that easy, But because we were there and we were so happy to be there, people were really, really very welcoming towards us. And here you can see with the workers at the exhibition, and there's the exhibition frames in the background. Here I was at one of the gala events. He's from Bahrain. He came up to me and shook my hand, and it was just so nice to see that there you have somebody wearing a yarmulke here, somebody with like a kafir, and we were like philatelists sharing the same passion. It was a beautiful thing to see. Now, what happened is one morning, you know, we'd go down for breakfast, we'd just have coffee and some fruit. So the daughter of the Iranian came up to my wife and I, and they said, she said to us, how are you keeping kosher in Jakarta? And that really broke down barriers, because we started speaking to her. And I was a little bit afraid, how am I going to react with her father, who was the Iranian commissioner? And at the end of the exhibition, they had the main FIP Congress. That means all the countries in the world, it's like a mini UN, but this is official, this is not private, this is governmental. It has major implications because they decide where the next exhibitions are going to be, what stamps are going to be issued. It's dealing with philatelic, which is the postal system of post and telecommunications. So it was a very big, it was a full day event where they had the different countries. South Africa was represented as well. All the countries, most of the countries in the world were there. And those that weren't gave their proxies. But Ireland didn't come. So I sat next to the Iranian. And there we were, and we spent the whole day sitting next to each other. Now, I had seen the Iranian movie that won the Oscar Awards that year. And I just mentioned to him, you know, it was a very good movie that won the Oscar Awards. And we really started speaking. And it was just amazing because, you know, the fear that I had, how am I going to react to the Iranian, it just disappeared. And here we have together. Now, with this picture, I'm going to show you another picture. When they heard in Israel that I was sitting next to the Iranian, they wanted the pictures to be published in all the, it was in the Jerusalem Post. I was very friendly with David Horowitz, and in Times, Jerusalem Post and Haaretz. And I just thought to myself, you know, they were very kind enough to pose and to have the picture together. I don't want to put their lives in danger. And I think if I would have given them the photographs, it would have been published most probably on the front page of Jerusalem Post. And God knows what would have happened to the Iranian commissioner, because the news would have got back to Iran that we not only we shook hands together. So here is, I hang this on the wall. This is quite a, I never gave this to the press, but here is a better picture where you see Japan, Israel, and Iran on the top right, over here. And then over here is a picture of us shaking hands together. And we really became friends. We really connected very well. So these two pictures, I just felt it's not my place to endanger anybody's life. We did it without any ulterior motives. But that's very dear to me. So I keep that in my home. And I show people that because it is, barriers can be broken. Anyway, this is where we received our awards. So because Iran and Israel, we together, this was at an award ceremony for the commissioners, and then we stood together and we really got to speak to each other quite a lot. Here's a picture of, quite a nice picture of my wife and I with the Indonesians at the exhibition on the opening day. I hope you don't mind me passing these around. Okay, this is a very beautiful picture. I hope my wife won't be upset that I'm showing it to you, but this was also in Indonesia. You see the people are very, very welcoming, and it was like being in a different world. It was just so nice how they accepted us. South Africa, there was a safe and judge and a commissioner, Howard Green and Emil Minow, which is good on. It was wonderful having them there. Now, what happened is we had one afternoon free, and that afternoon I decided with my wife, and I actually pushed my wife, they got this very large tower in Jakarta. At the top, it's pure marble and gold. It's amazing. It's like a very tall tower. So we just got into a taxi. I had my yarmulke on. You can see, well, yeah, you'll see me without a cap on. And we went to the tower. And there, you'll see Lucy with the girls. They looked at us as, because there weren't not too many foreigners go to Jakarta. It's not a very touristy place. And going to this tower, It was a public holiday, so there were loads and loads of kids standing up in the queue. And one guy who spoke a bit of Dutch, and I knew my Afrikaans, he said to me, "Have you got some money?" So I said, "Yeah." I'd never done this before. So he said, "Come with me." So we walked with, and we walked right through all these loads of crowds that were waiting for hours in a queue. We got to the entrance. He said, "On the first floor, just put a few dollars in your hand and give a handshake." And we did that. And we went in, otherwise we would have spent the whole day waiting and we didn't have a whole day. But he approached me and we went up. So that's the first introduction that I got to. A bit of bribery gets you everywhere. But we actually got to the top of the tower. And I think the local people, seeing us Europeans or with a different complexion, the Yamaka I don't think really had an effect. But just that they don't see many Westerners in Jakarta. So they saw us as something quite interesting where we saw them. We thought they were fascinating. And this is at the tower where, and I walked very freely with my yarmulke. Nobody stopped me, nobody said anything, and it was just very nice representing one's country wearing one's yarmulke and proud to wear it. Now, also at that exhibition, we met the Japanese. This was the Japanese judge with his wife. And this is an interesting story. Here is the two Australian husband and a wife team, and they got married late in life. She's from Indonesian Christian. There are about 20 million Christians in Indonesia, but then a couple of million Muslim, but she's a Christian Indonesian, and he's, because I wore my yarmulke, anybody who had anything remote to do with Judaism would come up to me and they'd say my grandfather was Jewish. No, he said to me that he's Jewish. The Bensons, and we became very close with both him and his wife. And this was the Egyptian judge and his wife. And I told him that my wife had been to Egypt and I had been to Egypt. In fact, when I go back to Israel, I'm going via Cairo and I'm spending like half a day in Cairo. So I'd been to the different shuls in Alexandria, and I was very fortunate to be in the main shul in downtown Cairo, over Hanukkah, where I opened up the shul. So I told him of the different shuls that I'd been to, and we really got on very nicely. And here was just a picture of the Prime Minister of Indonesia, made out of stamps. It's a collage made out of stamps. Okay, now being in Indonesia, somebody said to me, I wanted to know, was there a Jewish community there? And I searched on the internet before I left and asked so many people. And said there's no real Jewish community. Anyway, after we came back, they asked me to do a report on our trip, which I did, and I went into the Times of Israel and was in Haaretz. And then I got an email from somebody. He's the only religious Jew in Indonesia. His name is Yaakov Baruch. He, at the age of 16, on the one side his grandfather's Muslim and the other one's Christian, and at the age of 16 his grandmother told him that she's Jewish. And he went to Singapore. It really changed his life. He wanted to know more about what Judaism means, and you can see he's actually very religious, and he's come to Israel quite a few times. This was held at the Kotel. He came a few months ago, and I said, "You know, Yaakov, I have to do an interview on you." He actually wants to come with his wife and his son. I said, "I have to do an interview with you." He said, "The only place we'll do the interview is at the Kotel." So at 2:30 in the morning, we were at the Kotel, the birds tweeting away there. It was incredible. And I put it on YouTube. You can see the interview with him. The only thing which I did, I edited out the part where his grandfather's Muslim. But here we had our interview. This is the only religious Indonesian. I actually took him and the head of the Jewish community in Jakarta that came to us for Shabbat, and I took them to our shul.
Doesn't look Jewish.
he doesn't want, you know, because of he's a lecturer in the university, so he has a Facebook page, but he only uses Yaakov Baruch. So he has got a surname, but he doesn't want it to be on the internet or anything. Because he has been once beaten up. Wearing a yarmulke in Jakarta, he was beaten up. And the governor of Jakarta, who's a Christian, I don't know if you saw in the news, only a few months ago, because he made one remark against Islam, so he's actually sitting in jail now. He had a 2-year jail sentence, and people said he deserved like 10 years, but he got a 2-year jail sentence for making a statement which they said was derogatory against Islam. So, you know, I've respected his views. I've never put his surname. He did tell me his surname, but I've just never publicized it. Okay, so now they asked me if I can. Next month, Lucy and I have been invited to Bandung. I think we can go back over here. Bandung is in West Java. It's part of the third largest city in Indonesia. That was a picture of Jacob Baruch at the hotel. Okay, you can go a bit more. Yeah, okay, this is it. This is going to be the exhibition in Bandung, which is West Java. And they asked Israel to participate. And I sent our entries. And it was incredible. One of the entries that I've sent is The Road to Jerusalem. And they said to me, can't you change the title to Israel, The Road to Jerusalem? So I've had to change the title of, it's a one-frame exhibit on that iconic stamp, the windy road going up to the Tower of David. So there's going to be a collection of The Road to Jerusalem, Israel, The Road to Jerusalem. I've got another collection that I'm taking, a one frame on the War of Independence, which is also something quite amazing. And all my correspondence that I've had with the Commissioner General and the people involved in this exhibition, which is going to be next month, has been extremely positive. Then they asked me, can't we send a literature? They have also, not only do they have stamps, they have books, literature. So I asked, can't we send an entry of literature from Israel? So I spoke to the Israeli Philatelic Federation, and they said they've just published Megillat Esther. Now it's all in Hebrew. I think, Stan, if you can go this way. You're going to see something. This is a first. This is Megillat Esther, about Purim. And I sent two copies, registered. They received it. It's all in Hebrew. If you go to the next. And this, it's all in Hebrew with stamps from all over the world depicting the story of Megillat Esther. And this is going to be one of the literature exhibits in Indonesia in Bandung. And I think it's remarkable that they accepted it. I thought, no way are they going to accept this. But they were so happy and they thanked me for sending the two Megillat Esters. And it's going to be judged in Indonesia as part of the literature. So we're looking forward to that. It's quite a procedure getting there, but we made all the arrangements. In Israel, you can't book from, we're going to be going from Singapore to Bandung, so I've done it through my travel agent over here. But the rest is actually quite good. And we both have South African passports, so it actually works out quite well. Now, I mentioned to you about in Indonesia, we met that couple from Australia, where the wife is Christian Indonesian, and he's Australian. So after that exhibition, a couple of months later, I got an email saying that the commissioner from Iran had passed away. And I'd been in contact with him by email. I'd sent him the pictures, and we had developed a friendship by email. And I was very upset to hear that news. He had passed away. So I sent them an email just wishing them long life. My condolences, our condolences, and wishing them a long life. And I didn't think I'd get a response, because in those days I didn't have Gmail, it was netvision.net.il, so that email came from Israel. And they did respond to me, and the son wrote saying that he really appreciated our condolences, and he said he's going to be in Melbourne in the next year, in 2013, and I was going to be the commissioner in Melbourne. I went with my daughter, and I met him. His name's Masood. And in Melbourne, this is the, he gave me a gift. And it's one of the most special gifts that I've ever received. His father, before the Shah, was deposed. His father had published a book, because he had been involved in stamps in Iran. And I couldn't believe the book that he showed me. It's in Hebrew and Farsi. So here's a book on Israel. There's no English in it. It's in Hebrew and Farsi. It's a book that he gave me with Israeli stamps, published in Iran. This was before the Shah was deposed. And he gave me the book. I think it's the only one that still exists. and here was his card that he gave me, and we developed a very close friendship. And when I got to Melbourne for that exhibition, the Saudi Arabian commissioner said to me, "I'll only shake your hand when you stop killing Palestinians." So it was like a little bit heavy to hear, because I was so, you know, with Stan, you know, you think, that was a bit difficult, but I thought, you know what, I'm not going to argue, I'm just going to just let that, you know, I don't need to shake his hand, it was fine. And what happened is, I was very close with the Turkish, who happened to be Jewish, and I actually took him to the shul. It was over Shavuot, and we made a minyan. And I was very close with the Egyptian commissioner. And also, there we were, I had my Coke, they had their whiskies, which they shouldn't have, except for the Jewish Turkish. But we were sitting there in the lounge, in the hotel. There was the Turkish, the Israeli, who was me, the Egyptian, and the Iranian. And there we were sitting, and we were getting on so well. It was amazing. We were discussing so many different topics without any boundaries. We were speaking about Lebanon. And it was just incredible, the interaction. And the Saudi Arabian commissioner, I don't think he made any friends. He just walked past. And I think he couldn't believe his eyes, seeing me together with the Egyptian and the Turkish and the Iranian. So, you know, it was quite amazing. But what was very interesting at that exhibition in Melbourne, I don't know, and a lot of Australians don't know this, and we've all got, most of us have got family in Australia, there was one joint stamp issue at that exhibition, and that joint stamp issue was to commemorate the Battle of Beersheba. And at the opening of that exhibition, where the mayor of Melbourne opened it, the head of the post at telecommunications, it was a very big exhibition, there were about 20,000 people came to that exhibition, it was on national news, and they had the Israeli Philatelic Federation that came, and they had a joint stamp. This is an Australian stamp which has got Hebrew on, and an Israeli stamp, and it's a joint Australia-Israel stamp, which is Hebrew, commemorating the Battle of Beersheba, where the Australian forces were very instrumental in that battle. So it was just wonderful to be there at the launch of the stamp, which was a big event which was covered on national television in Australia. How are we doing, okay?
Very well.
I hope that's interesting. Very
interesting.
Okay, so stamps know no boundaries, and you really go to different places in the world and you meet the most fascinating people that you never think you will ever meet. So I get the London Philatelist, and I saw that there was a book published about Jerusalem in Slovenia. Now, why would a book be published about Jerusalem in Slovenia? And I read the critique on that book in the London Philatelist. And then a good friend of mine said that the author of that book was in Israel. And I phoned him, and he was leaving back for Slovenia the next day. And he was staying in Goela Street in Tel Aviv, where my in-laws had an apartment in the same street in Goela. It's right on South Tel Aviv. So I phoned him and I said, "I'm coming to see you." He said, "It's late," in his broken English. He said the same. I said, I'm on my way. I said, "I'm in the car in 2 minutes. I have to see you." And I went to visit him. And he showed me the book, and this is the book that he wrote. It's a book about Jerusalem, the history of Jerusalem, from the early stamps till 1967. And he told me the most remarkable story. He had a Jewish girlfriend, an Israeli, went to the university in Ljubljana, and he met her, and he fell in love with her.
Where was that?
In Slovenia. And what happened is that, unfortunately, in the 70s, She was killed in a pagoda in Jerusalem. But this guy, Mike Fach, who has become one of my closest friends and dearest friends, he was an archer for Slovenia. And he put on his shirt a Magen David. He had a very close connection. He loves Israel with a passion. And he put a Magen David. This was a time when he was still communist. And they disqualified him because he had on his shirt a Magen David. But it didn't stop him. He collected Jerusalem. And I'll send the book around. What was interesting about this book that he published about his collection of Jerusalem, it was also helped. The publishing was also by the Slovenian Post. They helped pay for the publishing of this book. So that is quite amazing. Anyway, I got the book from him. What was interesting is the judge, and he also collects Mozambique. So we have so much in common. And in 2015, him together with a guy, Igor, they organized a one-frame exhibit in Kranj in Slovenia, and they invited Israel to be the special guest. And it was only for the countries around Slovenia, which included Germany, Austria, Croatia, Italy, and Israel. And this was their bulletin that they had at the exhibition. And on the front page is my friend Mark Vach. It's his cover of Jerusalem, very rare stamps of Jerusalem when it was in Tamil under Austrian, when they had the Austrian post office. But more than half of this book that was given to all the participants is about Israel. It's got the history of the Israeli Philatelic Federation. This is a special prize that we gave. And my wife and I were at that exhibition. It was wonderful. We actually won the Grand Prix prize, which was really quite a bonus. But it was in Kranj, in Slovenia. And we stayed with Mike. He had come to Israel previously, and he stayed with us. And we have a very, very close friendship. I speak to him, I'd say, at least twice a month. And he's invited me to come. They're having another exhibition in September. And again, it's for the countries around Slovenia, but they've invited Israel again as a special guest. So it's such an honor and a privilege to represent one's country. We did in Slovenia, we're going to be doing that again in Slovenia. And then we just published an article about the one frame exhibit in Slovenia that was in the Israeli Philatelist, and it was also in the Times of Israel.
What's the one frame exhibit?
So that's people that you just have 16 pages of a specific topic. So that exhibit in Slovenia is just one frame. So it gives everybody a chance. You know, normally it's 5 frames or 8 frames. If you've got a gold medal collection, it's normally 8 frames. That means you've got 128 pages. It's a lot of material. So people just beginning, it's a lovely way to encourage the youngsters and encourage anybody to collect stamps and to exhibit it. And I think by exhibiting the stamps, you get such a appreciation and such a love for philately. So last year, and 2 years ago, it's now 2017, in Greece, you know, there was a financial crisis in Greece, but Greece had an exhibition as well. And what they did at that exhibition, they said there'll be no medals, and there'll be no, it's financially, normally they help the commissioners, they help with the airfare, they help with the accommodation. They said we could only help with accommodation, there'll be no medals. They had this exhibition in Greece, in Athens, and they invited Israel. And I went with quite a large contingent, and it was wonderful because I'll just show you from this picture over here. They have all the different plays of all the different countries, and there we were in Athens, and I represented, I was the commissioner from Israel, and I had previously phoned the Israeli ambassador. And we set up a meeting, and on Friday morning, took a taxi, and we went to the embassy, the Israeli embassy in Athens. A very special lady, Irit Ben Abba, and what had happened is that Greece and Israel had a joint issue stamp, which is a stamp of Saloniki and Haifa. And we went to the ambassador's, the embassy, and we sat with her, and I'll just pass it around. We had a wonderful time speaking to the ambassador. Now, what's interesting is that the advisor, the special advisor to the Hellenic Federation, that's the Greek Federation, he's in his late 80s and he's still very active. His name is Moses Constantinos. He is the advisor to the Hellenic Philatelic Federation. He's also head of the Jewish community. Well, this was 2 years ago. And we met with him, he was at the exhibition as well. And I'll just pass these around also so you can see. But for me, what the most remarkable thing about that exhibition when they had the Palmares as the award ceremony, it was on a Motzei Shabbat. So they said, we've got a surprise for you. And they actually had gone to the trouble of ordering kosher food for me, which I couldn't believe that here at that exhibition, they especially ordered kosher food. I said, I'll attend, I'll drink, but obviously I can't eat. They said, no, that's not good. I said, no, that's fine. Believe me, it doesn't bother me at all. But they went and they organized through Chabad, and they had a kosher meal that they had paid for, and they just wanted me to enjoy like with everybody else. And what was interesting is that my meal was actually a bit better than the other meals, so I gave it to the other people in our delegation. Okay, something that my wife and I also will funny remember, Spain. Spain, you know, we have a very... we have a very sad history with what happened with expulsion in Spain. It was the golden age of Spain. The Jews were accepted and lived very well in Spain, and they, in 1492, we were expelled, but Spain invited Israel to be the special guest in 2016, and it was going to be held in a place called Zaragoza. And when I had to, and they asked me if I'd want to be the commissioner, so any opportunity, obviously, I'd take. And I said, oh, it would be such an honor and a privilege to be. Anyway, my communication with the people in Zaragoza, the Spanish Military Federation, they don't speak English. They really do not speak English, especially those living in north of Spain. So it was very difficult to communicate with them, but we managed somehow. And when we got to Zaragoza, they met us at the airport, and I went to the exhibition, and it was incredible. This exhibition, it was the whole of Spain exhibiting, and many women in Spain are also philatelists, so you had the best of Spanish exhibits, and Israel as well. And I brought the Road to Jerusalem, that collection, and I brought another collection from Lawrence Fisher. I don't know if any of you are aware. He's a originally from Rhodesia. He did a collection that won a gold medal in Germany on the Jewish homeland. A phenomenal exhibit about the whole history about Judaism, anti-Semitism, the state of Israel. And I think this is possibly the very first time that there's been something of a Jewish topic that was exhibited in Zaragoza. And a hotel was on a street called Calle Casso. Interestingly enough, that was the same place where the palace was, where they had part of the exhibition, where they had the opening ceremony. At the opening ceremony, they had the mayor of Zaragoza, they had the premier of the province of Zaragoza, and at the end of that road was once the Jewish quarter. So it was incredible that a hotel, the exhibition, and the Jewish quarter was on the one road in Zaragoza, Calle Casso. Anyway, my wife and I went, and we went one day to the Jewish quarter, what's left of the Jewish quarter, and I was wearing my yarmulke, and a girl came up to me, and she said, it's so nice seeing somebody with a kippah. Now, hearing somebody speaking English was so nice, but I said, how do you know about a kippah? So she said, you're the first Jew that I've seen in Zaragoza, which was quite remarkable. I wanted to take a picture of her, but she wasn't so keen, so I was just so grateful that she was there. This is at the Jewish quarter. It's just basically a building, and you can see the ruins where they built on it, which used to be the main shul. They said there was a mikveh, but the mikveh, we asked people, they had no idea what we were talking about. This is the building with in the Jewish quarter where the shul once existed. And then somebody said to us that in Zaragoza, I asked, is there anything Jewish? And they said, there is a Jewish bookstore. So they gave me the address of this Jewish bookstore, and we took a taxi and we went. And it's in the middle of a residential area, no shops, no nothing, just residential buildings. And we see this sign, and luckily it was open, but the person that was working there spoke no English, but he didn't really need to speak English, because as we went inside, we saw so many things that were Jewish related. And here they had books and so many artifacts of. They had a talus and a shofar. And here's in the middle of Zaragoza, where no Jews live, where there's no Jewish community. And here you have this bookshop, which with mainly Jewish books. So it was quite remarkable being there. And this is in the middle of Zaragoza. So I'll just pass these around. Okay. And what was, for me and my wife, I think one of the highlights of that trip, we did win a few large gold medals in Spain, and I wrote an article in the Times of Israel that the golden age of Spain has re-emerged. And it really was. They accepted us. There are really no words to describe how the friendship, and it was, there was such a genuine friendship that they showed towards my wife and I, and the appreciation that we were there with them in Zaragoza. And that we had bought our exhibits that they gave us, we really got exceptionally good awards. So the highlight for our visit was also at that Palmares ceremony. I'm just going to show you, at that Palmares ceremony, they said to me, the head of the, well, I'll I'll just show you here. I actually met with the, this was a member of the parliament where, that came to the exhibition, and with a joint stamp, this man was very instrumental in issuing the joint Israeli, the Israeli Spanish stamp, which is a part of the Calatrava Bridge, the entrance to Jerusalem, which is by Santiago Calatrava. This is the joint stamp. On the one side is from Spain, the other side is from Israel. And it was anyone who's been to Jerusalem, it's magnificent. Now they have lights going. It's the Santiago Calatrava Screen Bridge, which was designed by a Spanish architect. So at the Palmares award ceremony, I said to my wife and I, we've got a special surprise for you. And they had a wonderful band playing. And you're going to hear something. Because I filmed it and I took my video of that whole event, at the end of the evening I saw the minister who was in the government go up to each of the band members and shake their hand. And it was actually quite nice to see that, and I captured that on video. Here's the joint stamp one, we'll pass them around. Now, the last one that I've been to is just recently, before Shavuot, Finland. Finland had a European stamp exhibition, and they invited Israel, and I went there, and it's in a place called Tampere. Tampere is in the north of Finland, above Helsinki, about 40 minutes away from Helsinki. They once had a Jewish community, a small Jewish community, which closed down in the 80s, but it was going to be in the city called Tampere. And I was on the Midrachov in Jerusalem, and I wanted to buy the commissioners postcards of Jerusalem, and there was in a shop, a souvenir shop, and I saw these lovely postcards, and there was a blonde-haired woman who was speaking, and her accent was a bit foreign, so I said, do you mind if I ask where you're from? And I'm from Finland. I said, well, that's interesting. I said, where in Finland? She said, Tampere. And this is just before the exhibition. So we sat down, her name's Ruth, and I videoed her, because and she speaks Hebrew, and she's been to Israel 30 times. And the year before, when Lucy and I went on the Lithuanian tour, we went via Helsinki to go to Riga. And while being in the queue, we met with other people that love Israel with a passion, and they come to Israel every year. And I told them that I'm going to be the commissioner in Tampere, and they said they live in Tampere, and they actually came to see me at the exhibition. And I walked around in Tampere with my kippah on, and so many people came up to me out of nowhere. And they hugged me and they said, we love Israel. It was just so amazing to see that. It was really very special. So I wrote an article on it called Israel Philatelists on Top of the World in Finland. Because what happens there in Finland, Shabbat, we had Shabbat and we lit candles at 10:30. And at 10:30 it was still light. In the summer, the light comes out very late. So when they have the fast on Tuesday, any Jews living in Finland is a bit tough, because it ends very late. But being in Finland, a week after the exhibition, four people from Tampere actually came to our house they came for tea, and we sat on our mepeset, our veranda, and one of them was actually a gypsy, a real gypsy that she said there's been a large gypsy community in Finland, and she had a Magen David on. She didn't speak any English, but they have a tremendous love for Israel. And I went to they just had some lovely Finnish music, and I just attended. And a very well-known, I didn't know that he was a very well-known, but a Finnish piano player came up to me and he hugged me and he said, you know, I was in Israel when they had the Cast-led war in Gaza, and we were driving and a rocket was coming to our car, and we saw the Iron Dome destroy that rocket. He said, God, save me. He said, I love Israel with a passion, and I'm going to, when I return back to Israel, he's going to come and visit me on the Tuesday. He came to the exhibition, he gave me his CD, he's a very well known, his name's Piano Penny. It was just so nice to see, just wearing a yarmulke, how people actually came up to me and said, we love Israel with a passion. So, also what was interesting at in Finland, they had the Palmares, which was quite far away from where we were staying, and it was on Motzei Shabbat. So I actually walked with one of the Israeli delegates that came for the exhibition. It took us near under an hour to walk there, but it was a very beautiful event. They had philharmonic orchestras, and it was really magnificent. And at the dinner, I met the Egyptian judge, and we had a picture taken together. So, you know, it really is true that stamps know no boundaries, and they cross oceans and seas, and you really connect with people, the most remarkable people. Do we still have time? Okay, so I just want to show you, in South Africa, we're going to go back a little bit. In 2010, it was the very first time that I was appointed a commissioner. So if we can go back. Now it's going to be a little bit easier with the... So they had an international exhibition in 2010 at the Stanton Convention Center. And I was the... Okay, we'll go right, I think, to the very beginning. This is going to be much easier because it follows... Okay, if you can go back a bit more. Here we go. This was the International Stamp Exhibition, which was held in the Stanton Convention Center in 2010. And that was the year we had the World Cup. Crime decreased drastically during the World Cup. But it was a magical time being in South Africa in 2010. And if we go on to the next one. These were the different commissioners. So you can see there's Israel with the Israeli flag. Then they also had the flags above in the convention center in Israel and Pakistan. The two flags were side by side. And what happened is that the Pakistani, we can go to the next one, you can just see from the different countries, all the different countries that were represented at that exhibition. And we can go to our next one. Yeah, so this was quite interesting. So the Pakistani commissioner asked me, what does he eat? Because he keeps halal. So I showed him, I actually bought him a packet of crisps, and I said, here's the halal sign, here's the betting sign, just look for the betting sign or the halal sign, and you're going to be fine. Anyway, I saw that the Indian commissioner and the Pakistani commissioner avoided each other. And I thought, this is crazy. So I actually got the guys together, and I said, you know, I saw Tendulkar play here at Centurion, and we started speaking cricket. And then I said, I saw Imran Khan, and he was one of the greatest cricketers. And they started speaking with each other. And here we have a picture with me in the middle. Like I didn't make the piece there, well, in a way I did. But we have me in the middle with the Indian on the with the blue shirt and the Pakistani next to him. And they became friends. They actually became friends. So you see, stamps can really break down barriers, and it was quite amazing. But for me, Stan, if you can do the next one. Brian is also a member of the society. So Brian and Sylvan Uriah and Uriah and Morris Daniels, they were part of this, and we have others from the Society of Israel Philately, but they gave a special prize of a yad. And this was the yad that they had, the prize from the Society of Israel Philately, but they wanted to give it to a Pakistani collector for his exhibit. And they said, but this is a religious object. It was only meant to be for somebody from Holy Land or to do with Judaica or Israel. Anyway, we went past that one, but if we can go to the next one. So this was a letter that was from Jenny Bannersfield. She was the New Zealand commissioner. And what we saw the most remarkable thing, here in Joburg at the Stanley Convention, there was an exhibit from New Zealand called Out of the Depths.
It's called...
Descent into the Abyss. Now I've made a few copies of these, so I'm going to be passing these around. This was a collection on the Holocaust by Bruce Chedidoth, a non-Jew, and it was the most remarkable thing I'd ever seen in philately. What he had done is he had a whole collection depicting, oh, we can give them all, depicting the Shoah, the Holocaust, coming from a non-Jewish perspective. And we marveled at this collection. We could not believe that here was a collection on the Holocaust in the Center Convention Center, which was from a non-Jewish exhibitor from New Zealand. And I asked Jenny Mansfeld, who was the New Zealand commissioner, if she could get me in contact with the exhibitor, because we really wanted to do something with this exhibit. We wanted to make it into a book. We wanted to do something with it. And here's her letter to me. She wrote to Bruce, and she said at the end, it took quite a bit of time, but she actually did manage to convince him to send the exhibit, and he sent it to me. And I forwarded on to the Israeli Philatelic Federation, and it also went to the SIP, the Society of Israel Philatelists, in America, and it was published into a book. It was nice what Jenny wrote in this letter. She said, it was nice meeting yourself and your friends in South Africa. It is one of the best parts of philately, all the friends you make around the world. This is coming from the New Zealand commissioner. So this is the book, Descent into the Abyss, about his connection. And we made it into a book, and it's obtainable through SIP. And it tells the whole history of the Holocaust. And what I've given you each is a, we made a few copies, is I did a, it's not really a critique, but it's just a, they asked me if I could just explain what the book is about. This was published in the Society of Israel Philately, and I gave a copy of this book to the London, to the Royal Philatelic Federation in England, and the London Philatelist asked me to also write about the book. So it has gone to many places in philately, but what I think what is quite remarkable about this exhibit, and here, Stan, if you can go to the next one. Okay, this is the book, and you can go on to the next one. What he did here, and I'm just going to read, puts here that the book has been derived from our attempts to develop a philatelic exhibit which is tied a range of items, specific events encompassing the Shoah. While largely philatelic in content, the telling of the story is aided by the inclusion of non-philatelic material such as photographs, propaganda items, government documents, and magazine articles. I was particularly interested in the social side, which I had to write about. And what he did is he found letters, and he was interested in finding out who were the people in the letters. And he did his own research, and he found out who the people were actually in these letters. And he managed to get photographs, and he got two families in touch with these letters of people that no longer exist, that they didn't even know that they were part of their families. And he said for him that was the most rewarding thing. And when we decided to publish this book, he said, look, he's got no financial interest in it. He doesn't want any reward. He doesn't want any financial gain from it. He just wants people to read it and to gain from it and to learn about the Shoah. And I think it was actually quite amazing that here you have somebody from New Zealand, from the bottom of the world, actually, who is such an incredible collection. And I think because of time constraints, we're just going to go through a few pages and I'll just show you what's interesting. This was an exhibition on the internal Jew. And you can see over here, I'll just point over here, if you look at the postmark, it says the internal Jew. So not only does he tell the story, but he connects it with philately. So here he's got the poster, which is, it's quite common, but you have an envelope with the actual postmark of the eternal Jew is quite rare. So we'll just continue. Now, this was a, he shows also, this was a hotel in Austria, which was Jewish-owned, and it was taken over by the Nazis, and they made it into the headquarters. So he shows a postcard of the hotel, and there's a cancellation. Here are two shawls that, in Kristallnacht, were totally destroyed. And there's a statement, 6 million tears fell to the ground, the world stood still, it did not make a sound. And when I wrote that article for the SIP and the London Philatelist, I said, Bruce Chedidoff did make a sound. He actually has, he's published a book that is a witness to the Holocaust. Now, these two pictures of the shawls, a very good friend of mine, and also stamp dealer, Julian Gasalta, had a wonderful collection of synagogues that don't exist anymore. And he wanted it to go to the general public, so he donated his whole exhibit of postcards, very rare postcards of synagogues, to the Israel Museum. And they put it in a book, so anyone can go to the Israel Museum, and you can see Julian Gasalta from Johannesburg, from South Africa, he donated it to the Israel Museum, and the Israel Museum are very, very pleased to have it. And that is our history. These postcards are the only remnants that we have of the rich culture, the rich shuls that we once had, that no longer exist. And Kristallnacht was the precursor of the shattering of the glass, was the shattering of Jewish life and Jewish existence in Europe. So here he tells the story. Here you'll see, I'm just going to go through, we're not going to read it, but if you look in the, what I passed, I explain each chapter as we go along. But here he has the letter, and he writes about the person in the letter, which is actually quite amazing. If you can come to the next one. This was actually a very sad story, and I'm sure you all know the St. Louis, that went, they managed to get out of Europe, and it went to Cuba, and then it went to the States, and Roosevelt declined. And they would not allow it to dock in America, and it was actually sent back to Europe. And a few countries accepted the Jews, but about over 200 actually were sent to the death camps. So that's a stain on the world, actually. There was a ship that did escape, but we had no place to go. Here he shows also a family, and if we can make it a bit clearer, there he gives there's a table of what happened in Europe, the amount of Jews that lived in Europe before the war. And there he connects the family with the postcard, with the letter. So you can see that's a total of 8,300,000 Jews that lived, and he breaks down each country. And at the end of the book, you'll see he shows after the war the devastation and the total destruction and the decimation of Jewish life. So if you can go to the next one. Yahya, he managed to translate that letter from Hebrew, and in the book he has the translation into English. And unfortunately, most of these letters, the people that wrote these letters, didn't survive. And he did research. He went through the Holocaust Museum in Berlin and different Holocaust museums to find out what happened to the people that had written those letters. So it's quite remarkable. We can go into it. Here's another where he can see in Hebrew, and he had translated that letter, and also reading the contents of that letter. A lot of people didn't know what the letter was all about. And here he's gone to the trouble of actually translating what the letter is. Now this, if you've got the laminated that I made, this is on page... This is the Sun family. Okay, this is the Sun family, and he was a musician. And he got married. He was able to work before the war, although only in a Jewish orchestra. And he married his wife, and they had a child called Hannah. And what happened there is that there was a letter, you can see it's written to his son, and he managed to get the photographs. I mean, this is something you don't see. To have the letter and to have the picture of the people in the letter, it's heartbreaking. But not only that, he tells the history of what happened to the family and to the son, to the husband and wife and the daughter, how they met their deaths and how they were sent to concentration camps. So this letter, it brings alive, this is the only evidence we have of this family. This is basically the only tangible evidence we have of such a rich musical family that aren't here anymore. But he's brought this letter to life. So anybody who's related to the Son family, they can see, you know, what was lost. We can go to the next one. Here's other letters where he explains also, you know, different cancellations and from different countries, people that managed to escape, those who tried to escape, and the contents of the letters. We're not going to go into each one. Then, okay, now this is also, this has a Oppenheim family. So you can see, I don't know if it's evident, this was a family that tried to escape, and unfortunately, they weren't successful, and they also then survived the war. But this is evidence that the families, this rich culture once existed. We can go to the next one. This is a family that managed to escape. And enough, they managed to escape, and that's the boat that they escaped on, and they went to the States. So it was a bit of positivity as well. Okay. This is also, you can see it's quite well written from Lindenbaum and Fish, and he explains what happened. Unfortunately, the ending wasn't so good. They were sent to concentration camps. Now, this is very interesting. Okay, this, there's a town in France, if you can just make it a bit larger, with a Jewish name. It's called Bileyev, which is a Jewish town. And the Germans, you can see the cancellation on top, where it's got Bileyev, which is the town of the Jews. But further down, this was a postcard with the cancellation with the Jewish name of the town from 1911. And the next one you'll see in the address, where it's got Bileyev, has been crossed out, and they changed it. The Germans changed it, and you can see the German cancellation. They actually changed it because they didn't want a Jewish sounding name on a letter. This is of interest to me. It's a dentist with his registration, and any professional was mandatory that they had to register themselves, and after they had their registration, they weren't allowed to treat non-Jews and the pain of death. So this is from a dentist that this is his original registration. So when people say that the Holocaust didn't happen, Bruce, what he's done in this monumental work that he's done, it's evidence. We can actually see the evidence in front of our eyes. And it was for everybody to see. And I think this book should be should be published, and it should be in every library, in every school, because you actually see the actual original letters and the original evidence. If we can go to the next one. This is also about a family, somebody who tried to, they asked money from family. Unfortunately, the letter was never sent, and he never made it, unfortunately. Now, this was interesting. Wow, this, when I read this, I was shocked. The censors, if they put the censor over Hitler Yamak Shamor's stamp, as you can see at the bottom, and often the Jewish censors did do that in defiance, so they caught two of the censors and actually put them to death for doing that. So just by cancelling Hitler's stamp with a cancel, they were put to death. So it's horrendous. Here's another letter that from a family. And just gonna go. And then here was the, on a positive side, the Jewish Legion. And here you can see in Hebrew, it's written the Jewish Legion, that there were a lot of Jews that actually volunteered, and this was part of the Jewish Legion. And at the end, this is how he ends the book. And if we can just close in, just a bit before, stand. If you look at the table, it's so sad to see. There he gives each country before the war and after the war. And you see the 6 million that were decimated and perished. So for me, last year, we can go on to the next one. And there was the liberation. First thing, that's a miniature sheet of the liberation. So last year we had an exhibition in Jerusalem. And I phoned I've spoken often to Bruce, and I said, could we exhibit your book in Jerusalem at our exhibition? And he said, please, he'd be so honored if we could. So we did it, and he received, as you can see, in a large formal for exhibit. And I was so pleased that finally he's got tremendous recognition for this incredible work that he's done. And I think the connection between the letters that he wrote and the families that he connected with, and just going into the research, it's got so much to do with genealogy, because this is what it's all about, connecting families and connecting people. And I just want to end this talk, and I hope I haven't bored you, but the Israeli Philatelic Federation brought out a Haggadah of Pesach, a beautiful book of Pesach, where it's got stamps depicting the story of Pesach. And we know in the Seder we say, in every generation they'll stand up against us. Unfortunately, that has been true. But we also read about Pesach, and we read about the freedom. And what's very important about Pesach is that we retell the story from one generation to another. And that's, I think, what genealogy is about as well, that you're connecting the families, the generations. There's so much in common. And the story of Pesach with the freedom, with the symbol of freedom, it's our wish that B'Shana Haba, Yerushalayim HaBnia, next year we'll be all in Yerushalayim, and the festival of freedom, that we really will have freedom, and we'll have peace, God, Mashiach for all of mankind, and we should just know no more war. And I just want to thank you for inviting me this evening, and I hope I've shed a bit of light on the fascinating journey that I've been really privileged to be blessed with, because the people that I've met along the way have become very dear and close friends, and the experiences that both my wife and I have had are golden. There's just no words to describe. So I really want to thank you for giving me the opportunity to share with you just a little bit of an insight into what I've been doing and my wife has been doing in the last few years. And to encourage you all, if you've got letters at home, to keep those letters, to ask if it's written in Hebrew, to ask somebody to translate it for you. And if you've got those letters, and one day you do go back to the home, to Lita or Latvia, to look up where your grandparents, where your great-grandparents came from. It is a fascinating journey. And what you do in genealogy, how you connect one generation to another, it's all the same thing. And it's just been a privilege and honor to be here this evening. And Stan, I want to thank you for extending me the invitation, and thank you all for attending tonight. Thank you.
I'll hand over to Dave to thank you. It just became apparent to me right throughout this that as far as hobbies go, you just can't lick stamps at collecting.
Ladies and gentlemen, I think we really had an amazing talk by Les.
Yeah.
We're so pleased that he was present at this time to be able to give us this talk. I'm an amateur. I know Les from the Society for Israel Philately, and I've been trying, I think it's now nearly 2 years, to get enough material to make one frame. And I think I did mention to you what it was about, and gradually I'm getting little bits together, but I have to find them and try and put it into, because it's, as Les said, it's 16 A4 pages that you have to have in the frame. And I didn't have enough material. What Les has told us has really given us a story of amazing and fortuitous, or should I say serendipitous, discoveries which have contributed to his hobby and interests. And as he said, there's definitely a genealogical connection, because particularly with these letters, etc., they connect to a person, to a family, to a place, etc. And I wasn't even expecting that, Les, but there's more of a connection than I expected. It's obvious that Les has done much research and expended a lot of effort in finding the fascinating information that he's given us. For example, letters, postcards, etc. And the places that he's been, for instance, when he was with the Klugman family, we've already had one talk from Susan, from Susan, and they're going to give us another talk about that actual tour that they did. I think we must heed Les's good advice about keeping old letters, getting translations, and finding history in the process, because it's the history of our families. I've got a bunch of letters that were going to be translated, mainly some in Yiddish, some in Russian, some in Hebrew, by your old friend Zelik Badel, who passed away about 6 weeks ago. Yes. Right, because you were a neighbor.
So you lived in the same street?
Same street, yeah.
I just came
across the
road.
I didn't know that. And, yeah, small world. Les's experiences in various countries and his interactions with the people at exhibitions, and especially those that he expected to, and we all expect to be hostile, like various Muslims and Indians, etc., etc. And the photos are really remarkable. As I said, I collect some Israeli philatelic covers and other related items, but I'm really an amateur, and I'm still trying to make up that one frame with your help, Les. It's also, I think this talk has been proof that philately can get you everywhere. It's a universal, international, bonding, breaker of barriers, and it opens many doors. I'd like to thank you all for coming to this talk. I'd like to thank Stan for introducing Les as an old friend. And in recognition of this event, I'd like to present a certificate to Les, and also a copy through Stan of the HOD publication Blessings for Life, and which contains all the brachot for every occasion, and chagim and yom tovim. Just a little commercial, just before I do that. Our next event will be on the evening of July the 30th, in cooperation with the Johannesburg Holocaust and Genocide and Holocaust Society Association, where we will have a talk on. Sorry, I left the certificate over there. Let me fetch it. One moment. Sorry. Sorry, it will be titled A Search for German Jewish Family Roots
The Impact of Answers, and it will be a talk by Jeff Kelly Lowenstein. As I said, this will be on the 30th of July at 7 at this same venue. And I would hope to see everyone there. Liz?
Thank you. Thank you.
No, you didn't need to.
Liz, thank you very much indeed. Just in recognition of your contribution to our knowledge, the knowledge of the Jewish Genealogical Society and our participants, and together with that, blessings for life, all the brachot for Shabbat, Yom Tov, and every day.
Thank you so much.
And we are really
thank you so much. Thank you all for attending.